the moment that, you know, when we did the Osbournes, to when I was about, we only did the show for like 3 years, but during that 3 years, I was not in a good place. And it's because human beings are not designed to be famous.
Hi everyone, I'm Lily Cornell Silver and welcome to Mind Wide Open, my mental health focused interview series. Today I am talking to an old friend, Jack Osbourne, and we are talking about our similar family structures and what mental health looked like for us growing up in the entertainment industry, his experience with sobriety, and how COVID has touched his and his family's lives. Thank you so much for watching and I hope you enjoy. Hi Jack.
Hey Lily.
It's so great to see you. It's
likewise.
Been like a million years, I think.
Yep, it has been. Yeah. Very. You were a very small humanoid when I first saw you.
Yeah. So there are a lot of things that, you know, can cause kids to grow up faster than they normally would. And something that has definitely been my experience has been growing up, kind of being born into the public eye or growing up in the entertainment industry. And I'm curious if that's something that you experienced, if you feel like that made you grow up a little bit faster.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's funny. It's like, talking about relating to kind of my upbringing, I was thinking about this just before doing it, like mm-hmm. our lives kind of mirror each other. You know, your mother's a strong music manager. My mom's a strong music manager. Your father, musician, my father, musician. So it's kind of this, it's kind of funny. There's very few people in the world, I think, that have family setups, you know, as similar to mine. So it's kind of, It's kind of interesting.
It's always nice to talk to somebody who has a similar, because it's definitely a weird thing, like, and it's super unique.
Yeah, I think it does force you to grow up quickly, but I think a large part of that was my parents' willingness to be okay with that. Mm-hmm. You know, they were okay with me, you know, going out on the road with my dad for months on end and missing school. And they were okay with me, you know, doing things I probably shouldn't have been doing at a young age.
Right.
And you know, it's something that I've had to kind of, over the years, there's been bouts of my life where I've resented that, you know, where I thought like I didn't have the childhood that I think, I should have. But then again, it's that like, well, but I had the childhood I had, and that was the experience I had, and I feel like that what I gained from it was far greater than what I lost.
No, I've kind of fluctuated between like resenting growing up in a music industry family. And it's definitely, you know, it was a little bit different, you know, and didn't have like a reality show or anything like that. But still there were times where I was like, I didn't ask for this. I don't want this, you know? And then other times looking back on it now, especially that I'm older and it's not, you know, maybe as emotionally overwhelming, that I'm like, I really appreciate the uniqueness of that experience and you know, the worldliness and how much I learned from that. So it's definitely, you know, it's a both and, but
yeah, it's a weird, you know, it's fun, like having kids. Like I often go like, would I do things, you know, am I going to do things the exact same way as my parents? Like, mm-hmm. did they have it right? Like it's, mm-hmm. you know, it's something that you constantly, I think when you have kids, you often reflect. I mean, this is the time when you reflect on your upbringing the most.
Right.
Because it's, you know, you can only base your parenting off of what you experienced as a kid.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious too about, you know, your upbringing in the entertainment industry and in the public eye and how that relates or related when you were growing up to mental health. Cause it's something for me, you know, and obviously since my dad's passing, like my mental health and the mental health of my family is something that's kind of under the microscope, you know, and like something that's public. Like there's not really a way to escape the publicity of like my mental health and my trauma and what I've struggled with. And I can imagine it might be similar for you as well.
I mean, I went through a real rough patch, you know, from the moment that, you know, when we did the Osbournes, to when I was about, we only did the show for like 3 years, but during that 3 years, I was not in a good place. And it's because human beings are not designed to be famous. Like, I'm sorry, like, you know, and I'm sure you can relate, like growing up with a rock star father, you see like fame is torturous.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. And as a child, all of a sudden, it's like on this hugely successful show, which kind of happened very accidentally and not like, you know, it's not like we were like, yeah, let's go out and we're going to go do this thing. And it just kind of happened.
Mm-hmm.
And I really lost my way. You know, I struggled a lot with depression even before the show, you know, as a teenager. And then once the show kicked off, you know, I kind of fell into drugs and alcohol. And it was pretty aggressive. You know, I often joke that I picked up a good healthy Oxycontin habit and it just, you know, I ended up in rehab at 17 and I've been sober ever since, but it took a lot of self-work to kind of try and knock back a 3-year experience.
And that's, I'm thankful that you pointed out that aspect of fame, because, you know, when you're in the public eye and you're able to, you know, or your family's able to do what they love and be successful at it, like, there is so much privilege that comes with that, but there's also so much that people don't see in terms of the reality of what it is to be famous and what it is to be a public figure. And, you know, and that's why I think mental health is such a thing that's talked about in the entertainment industry, is because everybody's struggling with it in some way, shape or form.
100%. I mean, mental health issues is the great equalizer. You know, that you could be the Queen of England, or you could be, you know, a homeless guy living under a bridge in LA, and you're both dealing with the same, you know, whether it's a chemical imbalance, you know, some kind of traumatic brain, like some mental health issue, and it's going to affect you the same way.
Right.
And it's really interesting, you know. I mean, I have done having been sober for as long as I have, you know, I'm constantly on this kind of quest of like, you know, it's that cliche term, but it's like progress, not perfection. And it's like, all right, how do I continuously progress through whatever the universe is going to throw at me? And, you know, and a few years ago, I stumbled across this book, and I highly recommend it to you, your listeners. It's a very short book, but it's written by a guy named Sebastian Younger, and it's called Tribe. And it's essentially about PTSD. But he has essentially correlated, mental health and tribal structure. And it's fascinating. And, you know, he talks a lot about how having community and having, you know, kind of rules to live by, and having, you know, moments in life where there's rite of passage, how it's essential to mental health. And if you look at it, you know, as a society, we've only been out of a tribal structure for maybe 200 years.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not designed to live in single family homes in cities of millions of people.
Right.
We didn't evolve that way.
In a society that puts so much emphasis on the individual as well, and individual gain and individual success.
Yeah.
And back to what you were saying about, like, you know, the Queen of England versus homeless man analogy, like, mental health is absolutely the great equalizer, but at the same time, like, accessibility to mental health care is so disproportionate and so
100%.
And I'm curious, you know, just on the theme of community, do you feel like your experience in rehab was beneficial for your mental health, or was there negative portions there?
100%. I think for me, it gave me the opportunity to be a 17-year-old in a time where I was kind of forced to be an adult.
Mm-hmm.
It gave me a sense of community. You know, I met a bunch of young guys with a similar age, all going through the same thing.
Right.
It gave me a kind of a conscious contact with a spiritual, you know, some kind of, you know, higher power, spirituality. And that I found very grounding. I was very fortunate to where I've never questioned my decision, and I've never questioned the process. And I think, you know, having worked with a lot of people in recovery, sometimes people get stuck at that, you know, and I always just kind of accepted, like, no, this is what I need to do to feel whole.
And so, since being sober, do you still struggle with depression? And if so, how do you deal with that in a different way?
I will have bouts, and like, and you know, I got diagnosed with multiple sclerosis in 2012. Mm. And one of the, so the MS is as unique to the individual that has it as their fingerprint. You know, I could be sat in a room of people all who got diagnosed the same week as I did, and we all have completely different symptoms from it. But the most common symptom with MS is depression. Mm. And so I get these weird bouts of it. And for me, I, you know, I'm going through divorce. That was like, I was horribly depressed then. And I find I get a lot of, I feel better when I'm in nature struggling, if that makes sense. Like,
then at home struggling?
Well, yeah. Well, no, like I like it. And I've been kind of teaching this to my kids. I think struggle is actually really healthy for mental health.
Mm.
Because if you, especially if it, well, I should say struggle, struggling with a goal at the end,
you know,
I think a lot of kids get depressed at school because they're struggling through school, but they're not, they don't see the light at the end of the tunnel because they're like, what's the point in learning the, you know, geometry? Like, I'm not going to be an architect.
Right.
And so for me, I have to have struggle to create purpose. And, you know, when I hit these bouts of depression, I'm like, all right, cool. I'm going to go surf, just get out in the water. And mm-hmm. surfing is a struggle at the end of the day, you know, and all the best surfers struggle with great, you know, style and class, but like, you know, you're trying to tame a power greater than yourself. You're trying to use the ocean as like this, all right, I'm going to try and take what could be very destructive, a giant wave, and I'm going to utilize it to my benefit. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so for me, it's spending a lot of time, you know, outdoors and doing as many positive things as possible that elicit that adrenaline spike, which changes the way I feel.
In a healthy way. Absolutely.
Exactly.
Absolutely. Yeah. I, on my dad's side of the family too, actually, I have, my grandpa and, one of my aunts is diagnosed with MS as well. Mm. And so that's something that I've, you know, kind of seen the impact of, and my aunt has a similar experience where, when her MS flares up, it comes with depression.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, I mean, there's been times where it's just like, I'm at home, like crying, like right. No one's there. I'm just like crying. And it's like, what is, like, I went to bed fine.
Right.
And it's, you know, but I have to surround myself with, you know, with my tribe and with the people that, you know, give me good vibes. Mm-hmm. As cliche as that sounds, but it's true. Like I need my people.
When I first started this mental health series, there were a lot of people that were kind of concerned about me in how much I was sharing and how open I was being about my mental health. You know, 'cause they would be like, oh, this, a lot of the stuff you're sharing is really personal. And like, is that scary? Are you having a hard time with that? And honestly, like something about growing up in the public eye, I was just kind of like, fuck it. Like I'll talk about anything when it comes to my mental health. And for me, I think that was definitely born from like having my, you know, my biggest trauma be a really, really public scenario and not really having any privacy around that. So I'm curious if that's something that you've experienced growing up in the public eye, if you almost felt like it was easier to talk about your mental health because, you know, you were born without privacy around that anyway.
You know, I was in, you know, when I went into treatment, mm-hmm. It was at like the height of the show. So it was highly publicized, like when I was getting sober, and I chose to just embrace it and own it. I was like, you know, it is what it is. And so I've always been pretty comfortable about talking about mental health. You know, my mom famously says, you know, the media has such an effect on society. And she used to say, you know, it's cooler to be a junkie than it is to be overweight because mm-hmm. the way the media looks at you. And it all comes down to the optics of certain issues.
Right. And did you, I'm curious, something that I like to address a lot in this series is, you know, kind of the stigma around like male mental health and male emotion. And if you mm-hmm. ever experienced that, like having a more difficult time feeling like you could be open about it because you identify as a male, or if that wasn't something you really experienced?
You know, it's funny. It's like, I often will question, I'm not the most emotional, like, person. Like, mm-hmm. if you're around me, you're not gonna, you know, experience the full emotional spectrum from me. It's like a running joke I have with my girlfriend where it's just like, you know, if I have, like, you know, if I want to talk about feelings, she's like, oh my God, there's feelings. they're in there somewhere. I've cried in meetings. I've cried in therapy. I've cried in front of my kids. Like, I'm not afraid to elicit, you know, vulnerability when it comes to dealing with things, whether it is a mental health issue or just feeling what I'm feeling.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a lot of resilience to get to the point in which that it is needing a release. But, I mean, I'll tell you what, with my kids, there's no shortage of emotion having three girls in the house. It's like, there is a lot of crying over, and I'm like, okay, that's fine. You can,
right.
You can cry over only having one purple sock today and not having two purple socks. My one daughter has been wearing the same pair of underwear now for 6 months.
Okay, great.
We have to wash them every night. Only wear the pink LOL doll underwear. That's it. And it's a nightmare.
But giving her permission to cry about that and permission to feel about that, totally. That's huge. That's emotionally intelligent parenting.
Yeah. I will do the... Okay, explain to me why you're crying.
Right.
I'm okay with it. You
right.
just have to tell me why.
You know, I talked about this a lot in my series and talked about it with my mom a lot, is like how lucky I feel to have grown up with a mom that raised her kids like you were raising yours. It's talking about feelings and not telling me, like, don't cry. You know, it was, emotions were encouraged, but also like the logic behind emotions were encouraged. And if you're crying because you just feel like you need to cry, then say that, you know, and like communicate that. So I super appreciate that. And something that I know you guys have, your family has struggled with as of very recently as well, is COVID. You know, how has that impacted your mental health with it touching your family so closely?
It's weird. You know, my kids got COVID over the summer. And that was pretty, you know, I mean, fortunately, COVID doesn't rock kids like it does adults.
Right.
So it wasn't terrible, but, you know, no, my mom got it. There was a high risk. My dad could have got it. It was just like, you know, it was weird, but I'm not a panicker, mm-hmm. you know, like I'm kind of one of those people where I panic when it's needed.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, okay, like, she's doing the right thing. I was trying to be as supportive as you can, but like, when someone's sick, mm-hmm. your instinct is to go to their aid.
Right.
But it's like, well, I can't go help my mom because
right.
I've got kids here and I can't, you just can't do that.
Right. And that seems to be like the really isolating piece of it that so many people are struggling with, is yeah. that like, you can't go to each other. You can't be by each other's sides.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's tough. I mean, one of my oldest friends, he took his life in end of April. Mm-hmm. And it was just, you know, he was just dealing with a lot of mental health issues, and then the lockdown rolled in, and I think it just crippled him. And it was like, that was pretty tough. I mean, he was literally one of my oldest friends in LA. We were kids together. We got sober together and so it's firsthand, you know, seeing that, and it's painful, you know, I mean, it was a really tough thing to have to, you know, walk through with, you know, my friend had two kids and, you know, no one would step up to like clean his place out. And like me and another friend did. And it was just like, in the last year, I think I've lost 7 or 8 people to either overdoses or suicide.
Wow.
And it's really,
I'm so sorry to hear that.
Yeah. I mean, it sucks.
Yeah.
And it's really, it's been really odd. I, mm-hmm. you know, a very good friend of mine runs this beautiful organization, you know, and I definitely want to just give him a shout out just because it kind of goes hand in hand. But I think it's the Grief Recovery Institute, and their whole everything is how to process grief, you know, how to go through all the phases of it and how to, you know, and it's a beautiful thing. And I'm not the best at processing grief.
Staying present through it is like one of the most difficult things imaginable.
Yeah. And I put up a wall and I'll just try and forget it. I'm one of those people that I tend to forget pain.
I've also seen a lot of like, I've found hope in that. I've seen so many different mental health organizations and mental health oriented programs flourishing and coming to the front lines in this, you know, because it's, I think now more than ever, humanity is being put in a position where it's like, okay, we can't ignore mental health anymore. We cannot ignore mental. We've gotten pretty far, like pretending like mental health isn't something that needs to be prioritized, but we're at a point now where there's no getting around it.
Yeah.
What is something that is giving you hope right now?
I think ultimately my biggest hope is my kids. It's a really, because it comes down to, you know, saying service. Like if I don't do what I have to do for me, they suffer. But if I don't do what I have to do for them, they suffer. So it's like this, like I have to really, it's a lot of work, but it's so rewarding. You know, I mean, it's also a pain in the ass sometimes. But yeah, having what are you hopeful for?
No one's ever asked me that question back. That's so funny. I end every interview with that question. No one's ever asked me that question back. And I've never even thought about it. Honestly, something that I'm hopeful for is kind of what we were just talking about is I'm seeing this shift towards mental health as a real topic of conversation and not only be like, oh my God, like we need to take care of our mental health, like self-care. It now is actually like, these are the things that are happening. Like I'm seeing more movement towards tangible change.
Yeah.
And in my my generation, as we were just saying, like gives me so much hope, and younger generations give me so much hope because at least in my circles, like mental health is something we talk about constantly, you know? And when I'm with my friends, we do like a check in with everybody. Like what's something that's challenging for you right now? Like how's your mental health holding up? What's something that is positive for you right now? So those dialogues and those conversation and that movement towards tangible change is the most hopeful thing to me.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for being here, Jack. It has been such a joy to connect with you after all this time. And as we said, it's people who can relate to our specific experience can be few and far between. So it's so great.
You and I would come from a small tribe.
But it's a tribe nonetheless. Exactly. Cool. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And safe travels. Happy holidays. Happy New Year. And thank you.